Now, let's see if I take a church. If not, they'll be on the screen. We're going to turn to page number 6. I want to know more about my Lord. Let's all stand while we sing all 3 verses.
Much better than that. Well, I just think we in heaven. Amen. Praise the Lord. That was good singing tonight. Amen. I mean to know more about my Jesus. Amen. I hope you come tonight looking to know more about him this morning. Amen. I'm so thankful for you being here. It's so good to have our sister church, Sardis Baptist, with us tonight. Good to have Brother Darnell going to bring the message for us tonight. And boy, I tell you, if you ain't already felt the spirit of revival, it's here. Amen. And listen, we're not having revival just because we plan a message. We're having revival because the Lord's here. Amen. Amen. And I appreciate so very much, Sardis, you being here. We want to tell you how much we appreciate y'all and how much you mean to us. And I pray. The Bible says this in Psalms 133:1. It says, "Behold how great it is when brethren, behold how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity." Amen. You get this close together, you better be in unity. Ain't that right, Brother Darnell? Amen. And but I'm glad we are. Amen. I'm glad our sister churches, and listen, we're on the same team. Amen. We're striving for the same goal. See people saved, to see people revived, to see people helped. And I praise God for us and being able to work together. And again, for all you going. We're going to go to the Lord in prayer at this time and ask him to bless our our services tonight. Bless our services all week. And we want to invite everybody to come back and be with us all week long. Amen. We got a great lineup of preachers this week. Brother Darnell, of course, is going to be tonight. Brother Jonathan McNeese will be tomorrow night and Tuesday night. And Brother Steve Dempsey will be with us on Wednesday night. So looking forward to what God's going to do. But let's go to the Lord in prayer. Ask him to touch our service and ask him to be with us this week and bless this message, this meeting tonight. Brother Trey, take the Lord in prayer.
Father, we come to you tonight, Lord, just to thank you for your presence in this place, Lord.
Yes.
Lord, the air is electric with your spirit. Father, we can feel it from the time we walk through the door, Lord. And I just thank you, Lord, for this church, Lord. Thank you for these people that we call family, Father. We just ask that you be with us here tonight, Lord, just anoint the choir and anoint Brother Darnell, Father, and just anoint your word and hide him behind the cross, Father, and just preach him like this is the last time, Lord. We ask you just you move and you work on hearts, Lord. And Father, we've been praying for tonight for several weeks and months and I believe years to come, Father, and I just ask that you just move tonight, Lord. And I truly believe you will, Father. And Father, I just ask you to do this throughout this service, Lord. And we'll be careful, Lord, to give you all the glory in your precious holy name. Amen.
Amen. You can be seated tonight. Brother Brian, where'd you go? All right, come on up here just a moment. We as Ephesus Baptist Church are so thankful for Sardis, and some of you may be thinking, well, why are we all here tonight? Well, I'm thankful we can dwell together in unity one with another and come into one accord and worship the Lord together. You know, in the old days, they used to do this a lot more, Brother Darnell, and I think we need to get back to that. But one of the reasons why we wanted to show you some gratitude tonight from the bottom of our hearts is for what you've done to us and what you've done for us in our building program. We thank you for praying for us. Thank you so much for praying for God to help us in this thing. But not only saying, I'll pray for you, but saying, here, I'm going to help you. And the donation that you made toward our building fund was an unbelievable, unspeakable gift. I can't tell you how thankful we are for that. We don't take it for granted. We realize that was a great gift from you guys, and we want to, and there's no way we could ever repay it. We just hope that one day we can pay it down the line and do the same thing for somebody else. And but we appreciate you so very much, and we're not trying to repay you, but we just want to show you how much we love you, and I appreciate that. So look, we got something, a small little plaque that we want to present to Sardis Baptist Church from Ephesus. Hold that up so I can read it. Amen. From Ephesus Baptist Church. And it's got all of our families signed that this morning from our church. And it says this: family, like branches on a tree, we all grow in different directions, yet our roots remain as one. And you know, I thought about that, and Nicole said, make sure you explain to them what that means. So I'm going to do my very best tonight. We're all family. And we grew up together. Most of us in these communities are, most of us kin, if we be honest. Amen. We're really close. But we're family. Not just blood family, but spiritual family. The Bible says in Romans chapter 12, verse 5, so we being many are one body in Christ, and every members of one another. And we just want to tell you, we love you. We want you to take that and as a token of our gratitude. Miss Nicole rolling in the back, where it's from, and I thank you for it. But we want to say thank you, brother. We appreciate you. Amen.
I was going to share. I was at a revival down here. I don't know how long ago, a few years ago. Scott Whaley's here preaching that night. The message was about shake it off.
Yeah.
Talking about shaking up snakes off. And if I remember that, you got up that week talking about Project 419. And you're going to make contact with all 419 people in Ephesus, Georgia, or this mailing district. And I think you're reaping your reward, but this church was obedient to that challenge and that call from God on your heart, and y'all being rewarded for it, and I'm just glad Sardis was able to have a part in it. All right.
Thank you, man. God bless you. Love y'all. Yes, sir.
Well, we can't do any of this without him, amen. He's the one behind it all. It ain't got nothing to do with a program or a preacher or a singer or whatever. It's all about the Lord, and he's just been good to us, and I'm thankful for it, amen. So I'm thankful for you guys being here. Get comfortable because we get hot in here before it gets over, amen. If you start getting sweaty, just quit breathing so hard, amen. Oh, boy, it's good to be in the Lord's house, amen. Boy, as Brother Trey said, you can feel it in the air. That's the Holy Spirit tonight. That's him here, and that's him wanting to do something for somebody and help somebody, revive somebody, touch somebody. We're going to do that, and I can't wait for our choir to sing. They're going to come sing in a moment. But as of right now, this is what I want to do. Brother Ralph Caldwell has contacted me, and we got some efforts going on. As many of you know, South Georgia, North Carolina, South Carolina, Tennessee all got blasted by this last storm that came through last week. And South Georgia's in a mess. They hardly have any power. I heard today it said they might be almost 2 months getting everything back on down there, at least weeks at times. The people don't have anything, and they don't even have gas to run. They can't get gas to run their generators. So this is what I want to do tonight. Sorry, if you didn't come prepared, that's fine. F says you didn't come prepared, that's fine. But Brother Ralph said, I'm going to go down Wednesday. I'm going to get supplies to take. I'm going to get gas. I got a gas fuel tank I'm going to put on the back of my trailer, and we're going to fill it up 250 gallons of gas. But that's what I'd like for us to do as a community, is to take up an offering tonight. If it's just a dollar that you got, you can drop in the plate, or $20, whatever you want to give. If you want, if you would like to do that, we're going to take up an offering. If you don't feel led, that's fine. Praise the Lord. You just pray for those people, but we need to do something to help. So we're going to ask, if you would, these men that I asked to help me tonight, come around, grab these offering plates. These ladies are going to pray. I'm going to pray, and then we'll take up this offering. Is there four up there? God will take this money. We'll get it to those that are going this week, and we'll let them purchase the supplies that they need to take down there. And listen, God will bless you for us. Let's go to the Lord in prayer, ask him to touch this offering and those people that are affected, and then we'll let the ladies play. Let's pray. Lord, we love you tonight. We thank you so much for allowing us to be here. Lord, you're helping us, Lord, just by us joining together as a corporate worship tonight. God, we're helping one another. But, Lord, we want to be a help to those that are affected by this storm. We just pray that you put it upon the hearts of your people, God, to give how they see fit. And God, that we would use that money, Lord, to be a help to those people. God, just continue to bless them. Give them what they stand in need of, Lord. Let the help that they need reach them in a timely manner. And, Lord, just continue to watch over them. We thank you again for all that you do. And we ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
Thought number one would surely be me. Thought I could be what I wanted to be. Thought I could be on life's sinking sand, but Lord, I can't.
Down on my knees, that's where I learned
thoughts.
I remember who I was. I was lost. I was blind. I was running out of time. Sin separated. The breach was far too wide. But from the far side, so you made a way across the great divide. Yes. Left behind heaven's throne just to build it here inside. And there at the cross, you paid the debt I owe. Broke my chains, freed my soul. For the first time I had hope. Thank you, Jesus, for the blood applied. Thank you, Jesus, it has washed me white. Thank you, Jesus, you have saved my life. Brought me from the darkness into glorious light. You took my place, laid inside my tomb of sin. You were buried for 3 days, but then you walked right out again. And now death has no sting.
this tonight. Amen.
Amen.
Well, I'm thankful for what Jesus did. I'm thankful for the blood that's been applied to my life.
Yes, come on.
I pray that you can say that tonight, brother. If you can, I'm here to tell you that this man's about to stand up. He's about to preach the Word of God, the gospel. The Bible says if you'll believe that gospel with your heart, well, by grace are you saved through faith. Not of yourselves, it's a gift of God. You believe what this man preaches tonight about Jesus and his glory and his blood, you can be saved tonight. And listen, all you got to do is come forward and ask him. The Bible says, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved.
Right.
I'm thankful for the one that was saved this morning, but I know there's more that need to be saved.
Right.
That's why we still have revivals. Amen. We're just not getting together to have a get-together. We're having revivals to see people saved and see people revived. So I'm thankful to be a part of this tonight. Amen. And I'm thankful to have my spiritual mentor, Brother Darnell Teal, with us tonight. Brother Darnell was preaching when I got under conviction, 9 years old. We was at Cook Springs. Man, I tell you what, I had never experienced nothing like that. Amen. I'm talking about the camp. Amen. The Holy Spirit was good, but the camp was something else. Amen. We had a good time. But the Lord began to deal with my heart that week over there, and I bawled and cried my eyes out every night. Man, Miss Tammy, she was mean to me back then. She said, "You just hold it and see if you'll be all right." I'm kidding. She wasn't mean to me. She's so sweet. She was her and Miss Janet, and they were so sweet to me. But listen, I was homesick, but not for this home.
Yeah, that's right.
I was homesick for a place I ain't never seen before. I didn't get saved that week, but when I come back, I had that feeling every time the preacher get up and preach, something in my heart would start fluttering, and there'd be conviction that start to take place. We had a reunion service on September the 29th. Is that today?
Yes.
Didn't expect that to happen. 1989. Got born again on that day, and you've never been the same since, amen. Never been the same since. But listen, I wouldn't be where I'm at without Brother Darnell preaching the gospel to me as a young person for his church, like Sardis Baptist Church. About half y'all raised me and kept me out of jail and out of trouble. Like, I know some of y'all were shocked when the Lord called me to preach. I said, "Oh." I promise you, I shot more than you would. But God can do all kinds of things.
You're right.
But I'm thankful for the life that you have spoken into me and the difference that you've made in my life. And I'm thankful for Brother Darnell and the difference he made in my life and the difference he's made in all of our lives. Listen, you better thank God every time you go to pray that you've been able to sit under a preacher like Darnell too.
All right.
You've been able to be able to have a man of God like that be able to preach to you. And I'm glad to have him here tonight for him to kick off our revival services. So Darnell, you come on tonight. You just preach what the Lord laid upon your heart. I love you. I've been praying for you, and I know that you'll just follow the Lord. All right.
If y'all don't like my glasses,
don't look at it.
I pick up anything I can find that I can see through. I've worn all kinds. Right after Brother Kevin called me and wanted me to preach tonight, I started studying. And God placed something on my heart, and I couldn't get away from it. I gave up Sardis last month, and people said I retired. A preacher can't quit preaching, okay?
Right.
You can't quit. There's no quitting. As long as there's life in your body and you can move around, you got to preach.
Yep.
This is my eighth or ninth sermon I've preached since I left Sardis. So I haven't quit preaching. And every one of those services, I wanted to preach this message. But I wasn't allowed to. It's different. It's not your ordinary revival type sermon, I'll promise you. But I believe that it's exactly what the Lord wanted me to bring to you tonight. Amen. So if you haven't prayed, I pray that you will do so. And I've said a lot of times, you pray for me till the Spirit takes over, and then you pray for yourself and others. All right. I want to preach tonight on how to make a choice and live with it. Now, I want to see a show of hands of how many of you have got to make a big choice, either tonight or this week. You got something that's coming in on you, and you've got to make a choice. Let me see your hand. Hold it up real high. Real high. Okay, people all over the house raising their hands. We choose a lot of things. But everybody makes a choice. Some people choose the world and its pleasure and its gods. But some people choose the Lord Jesus Christ. And I'm going to tell you, that's the right choice. Now, but the choices we make today are going to determine where we're going to be tomorrow.
Right. Yep.
So you better keep that in mind. Choices are extremely important, and they need to be led by God. So the first thing I want to ask you is the choice that you're about to make. And some of you that didn't raise your hand, you got a choice to make too, whether you realize it or not. Is the choice from above. Let's read the scripture in James chapter 3, verse number 17. But the wisdom that is from above is first pure and then peaceable. You stand if you'd like. But the wisdom that is from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, and easy to be entreated, full of mercy and good fruits, without partiality and without hypocrisy. And the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace of them that make peace. Let's bow our heads and pray. Dear Lord, I thank you for what you have placed on my heart. Now, Lord, I need your help to deliver this message. I pray, dear God, that you'll speak through me the words that I need to say. Lord, we love you and we thank you for everything that you do for us. We thank you for these words that I've just read. So bless them now. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Is the choice from above. Now, God wants all of our choices to be seasoned from above. And let me tell you, we can't conjure up something and just get God going along with us.
Right.
And I believe that God conjures up things for us and then puts them into our presence. Yeah. We serve a real, live, loving God, and he knows exactly what we stand in need of. Yeah,
right.
Now, last week, the week before, I was in a tent revival. And preacher on one night before me, he made a statement, and it's really stuck with me. Over in Ephesians, it says, and he called some pastors and teachers. So what that's saying is that we are pastors and we are teachers also.
Right.
We preach and we teach.
Right.
And he said the difference between teaching and preaching, when you teach, you tell, and when you preach, you yell. So I'm going to do some preaching and some teaching tonight. And I pray that the Lord will give you ears to hear, and I hope that you don't get through listening until I get done, okay? So I pray that God's going to speak to your heart now. And these glasses, I don't know, them things ain't worth a flip, Jamie. I don't know where that thing is. You got another pair? Kimmy's got a pair. Come on, Chelsea, give it. Oh, man. He don't think I'm kicked. Lord. I can say. Now, Psalms 37 says, delight thyself also in the Lord.
Right.
Now listen to that. Delight thyself also in the Lord, and he shall give thee the desires of thy heart.
Amen.
Commit thy way unto him,
yeah,
unto the Lord. Trust also in him, and he shall bring it to pass. I have made some choices in my life that were wrong. I have made some business choices in my life that I did not consult God. I did not seek his advice. I did not seek his counsel. And I failed miserably. And if you've got a choice to make, you better realize that you better bring that thing before God. Don't, you're going to be suffering because of it. Commit thy way unto the Lord. Trust also in him, and he shall bring it to pass. That's what the book says. And let me tell you something. Don't let other people make choices for you that you're going to have to live with the rest of your life.
Right.
Young people, listen to me.
Amen.
I believe that there's a lot of young people today that other people make choices for them.
Right.
Well, let me tell you something, young ladies. If you ever get out there one day, maybe you're on a date, and he says something like this, darling, if you love me, you just let me have my way with you. You tell him to pack up his diapers and go back home to mama that you ain't got time to fool with that junk. Now, let me tell you something. You better listen. Choices have consequences. And don't think that only lost people make mistakes. As a preacher, dynamic young man, dynamic. The kids loved him to death. I'm not going to call his name. I'm not going to tell you what church he's at or was at. But he made two bad choices. The first choice that he did, he decided to run around on his wife. And then when he made that choice, he got caught. And then he made the second bad choice. This young, dynamic preacher of the gospel killed himself. Wrong choice. Oh my goodness. Adam And the woman, when they were in the garden, they chose wrongly. God says, do not eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, for in the day thou eatest thereof, thou shalt surely die. But they didn't listen. They made their own choice. And now, wherefore is by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin, so death is passed upon all men, for all have sinned. And let me tell you something, each and every one of us, death is on our trail.
Right.
The Bible says it's been appointed unto man once to die, but after this, the judgment. Now, I want you to realize that the choice needs to come from above. And again, don't let other people make choices for you that you're going to have to live with forever. Now, is any part of this choice that I'm about to make unscriptural? Now think about it. I don't care what it is you're about to make. Maybe it's a new car. Tammy and I got the car fever the other day, and it lasted about 30 minutes. We took two aspirins and got over it when we fried one of them. And Lord have mercy, I got to driving so good, didn't I? And let me tell you, the will of God for your life will never be anti-Bible.
Right.
God is not going to present anything to you that is against his precious word. This Bible is the inspired, inerrant, understandable, and authoritative Word of Almighty God. Amen. This is the greatest book that's ever been written. Right. It's the book of the planet. It's the greatest book in all the world. And let me tell you what, it tells us where we came from, and it tells us where we are, and it tells us where we're going at the end of the way. All right. So is any part of this decision unscriptural? I think about how people dress sometimes. And you know what? You don't have to dress up like a clown to go to the circus.
Right.
I mean, think about that a minute. You don't. And the Bible teaches us that we're to adorn ourselves in modest apparel. But the world is, I'm telling you, I mean, I saw a woman the other day didn't have on enough clothes to make a pair of breeches for a blue jay. And let me tell you, I mean, it's unreal. It's unreal, so we need to wake up. Is there any part of this decision unscripted? Psalms 119, 105, thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. We got to follow that. And I want to tell you something. If you forsake Scripture, you will never, never, never find that light. If you want an answer to your decision and your choice, you better consult the Word of God. You better see what He has to say. And I'm going to tell you something. If you'll listen to God, boy, things will be better. I've never seen anybody starve to death that loved God and that followed His precious Word. And let me tell you this. You don't have to substitute pleasure for Jesus. I've heard people say, oh, if I get saved, I won't ever have any more fun. Uh-oh. Oh, that's so ignorant. I mean, that's just totally ignorant to me. Right. The Bible says that thy right hand are pleasures forevermore. Yeah. And let me tell you what, he means that.
Yes, right.
The best day that I had when I was lost, it can't compare to the worst day I've had since I've been saved. I'm telling you, God is good, and at His right hand are pleasures forevermore. Now, let's go a little further. Will these choices bring discord or division? Oh. My job at the house is not to bring in money. What? Men, that's not your job. That's God's job. And when we make the right choices, God is going to provide. I'll promise you.
Right.
Now, what are we to do? We're to keep unity in the home. If you got kids, you need to help take care of the kids. We need to train up our children in the nurture and the admonition of the Lord.
Right.
And if we'll train them, when they get up older, the Bible says they'll not depart from it.
That's right.
Now, I used to bird hunt. Kevin used to bird hunt. Boy, I'm telling you, if you hadn't been on a good quail hunt, you missed it. But you could raise a bird dog, and he'd run up every covey in the woods. But you could train him, and that joker locked down. Boy, I'm talking about he'd lock down on them birds and have a ball with it. I'm telling you. We train it. We don't just raise our kids.
That's right.
We train up our kids. Now, and we're to live peaceably, it says in that verse. If God's in it, then it will bring peace. If God's not in it, it's going to bring division. And the Holy Spirit will not sow confusion, but the Holy Spirit will sow peace.
That's right.
Now, peace like a river. Well, you know, one of the most peaceful places you can be is on a river. I grew up on a river. Boy, when I was a kid, every time I had a chance, I was down on that little Tallapoosa River. I knew every square inch of the banks, and I knew how deep the water was, and knew where to catch the fish. And boy, I'll tell you what, we had a time. Well, we'd put out trot lines and put out set hooks, and if we couldn't catch them that way, hey, I wasn't a Christian, then we'd dynamite. I mean, boy, I'll tell you what. But boy, we get some fish. Y'all remember the bar farm? I may get locked up after this, but we dynamited the bar farm one time down in that swimming hole. Some of you know where it's at. And Lord, that first day fish come up, it's unreal. Now, I'm running rabbits. Now, I don't know how I got on all that. Now, but listen to me. Now, listen to real carefully. Our opinion is best kept to ourselves if it's going to create confusion.
Right.
Let me say that again. Our opinion is best kept to ourselves if it's going to create confusion. Now, me and Tammy ain't been married very long. We got married in January. But I know the right button to push to get her stirred up. And she knows the right button to push to get me stirred up. Now, if you don't think preachers ain't got a temper, you got your head in the sand. Well, let me tell you something. I can get as angry as anybody in the world. The Bible says, be ye angry and sin not. Yeah. That means I can get mad at Tammy, but I just can't slap her. Now, so, but now listen. Is my choice going to place a burden on someone? Is it going to place a problem on someone? Our choice. I got put out what I was going to wear, and I got out my Georgia Bulldog red tie. Boy, that thing's sharp, son. I'm talking about it's sharp. And then I thought about what I was preaching about. Will it cause a problem on somebody? I didn't know how many Alabama fans they were down here. I don't have a clue. Y'all got scared last night, though, I guarantee you. Well, let me tell you what. And I'm married. That ain't a cuss word. I married a dad blame Alabama fan. She don't get a crick in that one. Okay. I got to tell y'all this. We was meeting at the restaurant one day. We're getting ready to build the nativity scene. We've been doing it for years and years at Sardis. This Alabama fan came in, and he said, that's when Georgia was about to play Alabama or something. I don't know exactly what. He said, I just got one word for you guys. He remembered it. I said, what's that? He said, roll tide. I said, boy, when I went to school, that was two words. And, Alabama fans, roll tide is one, two. Two. One, two. How many Alabama fans you got in here? God bless you, sweetheart. Hey, I love y'all anyway. I guarantee you. All right, let's go a little further. Now, I want to tell you something. Maybe you're praying for a job. If you pray for a job, it ought to include your family and your church and your testimony. I have had job offers before in my life that would hinder either my church or my testimony, and I had to say no. I couldn't take that job. We need to let our choices be made in heaven and let Him reveal it to us. Just like I said, and let me tell you, parents, we've got a job to do. We live in a hell-bound world, and we need to be training our kids. And let me tell you, if I win every child in the world and lose my own, I believe I failed.
Right. Yep.
Don't lose your own kids. Whose place is it to win them? Your place, daddies.
Right.
I tell you what, we got some lazy daddies that don't ever read the Bible, and then you wonder why your house is not in order. You wonder why you're fussing and griping and complaining, and you never get close to God. You never read the book. You never pray. Come on, folks. We better get at it. I'm telling you, the Lord's going to push a curtain call here pretty quick, and He's going to step out of glory and say it's enough. He's coming for His church. Are you ready? I hope you are. Now, gentle and easy to be entreated. That word entreated means entreat it. It's how you treat people. How do you treat people? Have you got a bad attitude toward people? Some people do. Some people, they gripe about everything, and they don't like anything you do, and they moan and groan and complain about it. I know I run into people every day. And I saw a sign the other day, and I got a dog that I love dearly. And this sign said, the more I'm around people, the more I love my dog. I love people. God put in my heart a love for people. And you need that same love in your heart too. Now, easy to be intrigued. The first lady that was ever in the parliament in Britain was a lady by the name of Lady Astor. And she was, like I say, the first lady in the British parliament. And she had an attitude. And she told Winston Churchill one day, and some of you remember Winston Churchill, he's before most of you's time, but he looked like a bulldog smoking a cigar. I mean, that's true. He had a bulldog face. But Lady Astor said to him, if I was married to you, Churchill, I'd put poison in your coffee. Mm-hmm. Churchill said, Lady Astor said, if I was married to you, I'd drink. Then a few days later, she said, Churchill, you're drunk. He said, yeah, and you're ugly. But tomorrow I'll be sober. But you know, that's not the way to treat people. We need to treat people the way we want to be treated.
Right.
When we do, we're going to come out on top of that. Now, maybe there's something you want. Do you need it? Bible says, full of mercy. Psalms 103, verse 1 and 2. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name.
Yes.
Think about that. Hebrews 13, 5 says, let your conversation be without covetousness, and be content with such things as you have. If you're trying to keep up with your neighbor, you're going to be in a mess. Okay? I think that too many people want something that they cannot pay for. We'll quit drinking Cokes and saving enough money to make a payment. That's about the poorest example I've ever seen in my life. You can't do that. If you can't afford it, don't buy it, okay? That's just that simple. Now, 1 Timothy 6 through 8. But godliness with contentment is great gain.
Right.
Well, we brought nothing into this world, and it is certain we carried nothing out.
Right. Yep. Amen.
And having food and raiment, let us be content. Well, you know, I got to thinking about that a long time ago, and I said, boy, if I can't take it with me, I'm going to send it on over on the other side. The Bible says, lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven where the moth and the rust doesn't corrupt and the thief don't break through and steal. Hey, I'm laying up treasures on the other side, and God's keeping a record, and he keeps a record about you too.
Amen.
Even a cup of cold water given in the name of a disciple will not go unrewarded. We're to live for other people. We're to serve others. That's the way we can live like Christ. Listen to this, Psalm 37. 3-5. Trust in the Lord and do good, and so shalt thou dwell in the land. And verily shalt thou be fed. Delight thyself also in the Lord, and he shall give thee the desires of thy heart. Commit thy way unto the Lord, trust also unto him, and he shall bring it to pass. We've got to put our trust in the Lord. Now, we talked about different decisions. The greatest decision you will ever make is what I'm fixing to talk about. The greatest decision you will ever make. Now let me tell you something. At salvation, we chose the Lord, but he chose us first.
Right.
John 15:16 says, ye have not
chosen me, but I have chosen you. Some people said, when I found the Lord, well, the Lord wasn't lost. It was me. And the Lord was searching for me. And I'm going to tell you something. The Lord caught up with me. He showed me my lost condition. One night I called on him and he came into my heart and he saved my soul. Now, I want you to listen to the last charge that Moses gave. Deuteronomy 30:19. I call on heaven and earth to record this day against you. God's keeping a record of what we're talking about tonight and what you do with it. He said, I call on heaven and earth to record this day against you. I have set before you life and death, blessings and curses. Therefore, choose life that thou and thy seed may live. You got a choice to make. And that choice is for the Lord Jesus Christ to come into your heart and save your soul. Now, everybody knows that after Moses said this, it wasn't long that he went up the mountain and he died and God buried him. And the Bible says, no man has found his body until this day. Now, that means they're looking for it. I went to the Holy Land back in 79, and they was on that mountainside digging, trying to find the body of Moses. I thought, you idiots, why don't you read the book? He said, no man has found his body till yet. They're not going to find him. God buried him. And he buried him for a reason, a purpose. We don't get into all that. But that'll preach. But then when Joshua took over, the people that served the Lord for a while, and then they'd start worshiping idols, and he got all the people together at a place called Shechem, which is a great historical place in the Bible. A lot of wonderful things happened there. But he got all the people together, and he put six tribes on one hill and six tribes on the other. And Joshua stood in the middle of them. And let me tell you, he began to tell them just exactly like it was. He says, if it seem evil unto you to serve the Lord, if you don't want to get saved, don't. If you don't want to go to heaven, you'll bust hell wide open. You ain't got to go to heaven. There's two choices. You can either go to heaven when you die, or you can go to hell. But the Bible says there's two places, and there's no purgatory where you go till everything gets straightened out till you get there. Those Catholics miss the boat.
Right.
They don't know what they're talking about when it comes to that kind of thing. The Bible says, as death finds you, so shall the judge. If it seems evil unto you to serve the Lord, then choose who you want to. Choose your gods. The gods that were on the other side of the flood are the god of these people in whose land you dwell. But Joshua said then, but as for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord.
Yeah.
And let me tell you something, folks. As for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord.
Right.
I mean, there ain't nothing this world's got to offer me that's worth going to hell for. Hey, Jesus went to an old rugged cross and died for me. He gave me the choice. I can choose Christ or I can not choose him. But boy, whenever I asked him to save me, he did.
Amen.
He saved my poor, wretched, sin-sick soul. Jeremiah said the same thing. Thus saith the Lord, behold, I set before you the way of life and the way of death. Who wouldn't choose life? My goodness. I mean, I'm here to tell you, the Bible says in him is life, L-I-F-E. If you want that life, you've got to accept Jesus Christ as your personal Savior.
Right.
Now, the Bible says that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus.
Yes.
And shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead. He said, thou shalt be saved.
Amen.
He said, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation, and with the heart, I done messed that up, that's all right. Let me tell you what God knows all about.
Amen.
And then he said, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall
right.
be saved.
Yeah.
thy heart the Lord Jesus, and believing thou in thy heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. I lost it again, so I ain't going to do it again. You ever go blank on something? Let me tell you this. Then he said, whosoever believeth on him shall not be ashamed.
Right.
Why would you be ashamed of anybody that loved you enough that he went to a cross and died for you? So I said, the greatest choice you'll ever make. And you're going to make that choice tonight if you're lost. You say, oh, not me. Well, let me tell you what. Your indecision will be your decision. He said, if you're not for me, you're against me. He that gathereth not with me scattereth abroad. So choose you this day whom you will serve. I pray that tonight there's going to be some rededications. I pray that somebody's going to get saved. I pray that you'll let the Lord rule and reign in this service, in this invitation. So let's get our Angie come, and we're going to have an invitational song. Decision time. The Lord wants you to choose Him. He knows all about you. Have you accepted Christ as your personal Savior? If not, you stand and come publicly tonight. Jesus died publicly for you, and everybody he called in the New Testament, he called him publicly. Don't be ashamed of it. He died for you. Let's stay.
I know who I am, 'cause I know who you are. The cross of salvation was only a star. Now I am chosen, free and forgiven. I have a future. And it's worth the living. 'Cause I wasn't made to be tend in the grave. I was called by name, born and raised back to life again. I was made for more. So why would I make a bed in my shame when a fountain of grace is running my way? I know I am yours, and I was made for more. I know who I am, 'cause I know who you are. The cross of salvation was only now I am chosen, free and forgiven. I have a future, and it's worth the living. 'Cause I wasn't made to be tending the grave. I was called by name,
Tend in a grave, I was called by name, born.
sing out your praise. Hallelujah. You buried my past, so I'm not going back. Hallelujah. You call out my name, so I'll sing out your praise. Hallelujah. You buried my past, so I'm not going back.
I was made to be sitting in a grave. I was called by name, born and raised back to life again. I was made for more. So why would I make a bed in my shame when a fountain of grace is running my way? I know I am yours, and I was made for more. Why was I made to be tend in the grave? I was called by name, born and raised back to life again. I was made for more. So why would I make a bed in my shame when a fountain of grace is running my way? I know I am yours, and I was made for more.
Back tomorrow night, get another slice of what God has for you, Brother John. their home, there was a 15-mile stretch where there was not a single house.